You either have the war or you don't have the war. Well, as the concept began, it is a war not of military might, not of economic might to a large degree. It is a war of ideas. Beginning in the early 1920s, there arose in the world two ideologies, basically two economic systems, capitalism and communism. Include communism in quotes. We won't qualify that. Those two ideologies completely contradict each other. They have to clash because they approach the human being from two different viewpoints. So before I can get into the Cold War, let me start by trying to define these two ideologies. And I want to get my high-tech bill ready. We start with capitalism. Capitalism, right, so wonderful. Capitalism is first described in 1776 by Adam Smith. Adam Smith, as he surveyed and looked at the economic life, think, how do you make a living? As he described it, and he labeled it capitalism, but he didn't invent this. This is the way people were making a living. This is the way they were making a livelihood. All right, first of all, he says, it's obvious that if you're going to do economics, you must have a free market. There must be a place that you can come to buy and sell goods. Nothing happens until someone sells something. And so therefore you have to have that marketplace. That marketplace must be free. It cannot be hampered in any way. You must have that total freedom to say, this is my price, this is what I'm going to pay for. And somewhere along the line, you have to come together. That makes a market. So when you talk in terms of the free market, always keep in mind it's a place and it has to be a compromise on the buyer and the seller. All right, so Adam Smith says you've got to have that free market. He said then, in order for the free market to operate, there must be competition. You cannot, it's impossible for a free market to operate if one source only is available. Because that means the buyer cannot negotiate. So therefore you have to have more than one source of the product. So we're talking about the fact that there must not be a monopoly of a product. So therefore, you have, again, by competition, if you can't come to an agreement with one vendor, you can always go to another vendor. And there you can negotiate. So you have a free market plus competition. Now, all of that is governed by a, quote, natural law. And I always put that in quotes, too, because a natural law may or may not exist. But according to Adam Smith, indeed, he said the law of supply and demand. Now, what he's referring to is, if I have a product, let us assume that I'm a sheep raiser and I shear my sheep. I take it to the market at the same time that everybody else does. But what happens if the next year I get wise? I say, wait a minute, I got a solution here. I'm going to shear my sheep early. I'm going to be the only one at the market. So I shear those sheep. I don't have as much wool because they didn't have time to grow that much. I take the wool to the market. I'm the one there. Therefore, the price is high. What I have lost in quantity, I have made up in scarcity. So therefore, I have the supply and the demand is there. Therefore, the price is determined in such a way. All right, so that's capitalism. That is basically the way people make their living. Now, you can get in all kinds of arguments whether or not the market is free or not today. I'm not getting into that. I'm looking at it strictly as the theoretical capitalism. Okay. Now, communism is a different ideology. Communism was invented. It was invented by a man by the name of Karl Marx. Karl Marx is a historian, and he's a leader. Karl Marx researched and developed the economic history. And in that economic history, he said, I have discovered three laws of nature. Again, put those in quotes, please. He says, the laws of history. He said, first of all, that the whole economic life is what he called economic determinism. He says everything that we do is determined by our economic self-interest. We are nothing more than economic animals. Everything we do revolves around our economic self-interest. That's Marx. And he saw that in history. Now, obviously, you're sitting here right now and thinking about this. Now, come on, that's a little far-fetched. To a large degree, it is. That's not the way Marx saw it, so keep it in mind. Right, so economic determinism lowers us to that economic level. Then he comes together with dialectic materialism. He says that as he studied history, he found that in every civilization, every society, there are two classes. Now, let's assume that this will represent a civilization or society. Marx used the term for that as a synthesis. That's how people live, in a synthesis. He says inside that synthesis, inside that civilization, there are two classes. He says, and he gives them names. One class is the thesis. The other class is the synthesis. He's got to be a little bit of a poet. The synthesis, thesis, and all of this. But he says that there are two classes. Boils down. The haves and the have-nots. Now, he says that the haves and the have-nots will invariably clash. They'll go to war. As they clash, you have class warfare. Now, out of that class warfare, there will arise another synthesis, a new creation. another society. But that society will also have two classes. And, as he says, in history, those two clash. We have the class warfare. Out of that, you've got a synthesis. Now, you look at history, and I can almost agree with Marx. I don't believe in the laws of history, but he did. But you take a look, let's drop back to the medieval period. You have two classes, the nobility and the peasant. Alright? Following that medieval period, then you would have what I refer to as mercantilism as their economic system, and they have two classes. Alright, after mercantilism, you follow that, and it's capitalism. And remember, Marx is writing in the 1840s, 1848, 1849. He's right in the midst of the Great Industrial Revolution. And conditions are terrible. Will you have two classes in the 1840s with the Industrial Revolution beginning? You better believe it. There will be two classes. And Marx is just waiting on the fact that everything that he studied is true, they will clash. He thinks that once they clash, a new civilization will be created. Now, Marx will march it right on up. Because if you go with, well, I'm going to run out of space here, but let's go with the fact that let's label this with capitalism. All right, following the revolution in capitalism, you will have socialism. Now, the point of socialism, notice how easy that was to do. This is correct. Socialism is to make everyone equal. When that happens, human nature will change. That they will move away from this haves and have-nots. They'll move away from the two classes, and a new civilization will arise, and it is communism. Communism changed the human nature. So therefore, you no longer are an economic animal. Marx says that everyone will work according to their ability and will be rewarded according to their need. So you're no longer an economic animal. Human nature has changed somehow from the time of socialism to the time of communism. Then he says, and since that will have changed, there will be no need for government. The state will wither away. That's his term. All right, so communism then becomes utopian. It's heaven on earth. You don't have any government, you don't have any taxes. Everyone is treated the same. Everyone is equal. So, and everyone is humanitarian. You're going to be working. No matter what you make, you will be rewarded according to your need. So, this is utopia. It is heaven. All right, because of that, communism takes on some of the attributes of religion. You think about it. You have a savior called Karl Marx. You have the move toward heaven. You have the utopia that's going to be created. So there is a major conflict then between what capitalism sees and what Marx sees. Now, There is a third law of history that Marx sees, and he says communism is inevitable. Can't be helped. It's going to happen. The class warfare, the dialectic is going to continue until you reach communism. It is the wave of the future. So therefore, he is firmly convinced that he has studied history and he has found the laws of history. Capitalism, on the other hand, is kind of messy. Because you're not sure the market will be free. You certainly are not sure that the competition will be there. And the law of supply and demand can be corrupted. So capitalism is messy. Communism is well set up. It's orderly. Except for the class warfare. Okay, now these two economic ideas existed in the world at the same time. Now, as they existed, they are antagonistic to one another. But two countries come to represent the two different ideologies. The United States came to represent capitalism. The Soviet Union came to represent communism. All right, so now you are going to put concrete pigments, if you wish, to the conflict. As those two countries develop their economic systems, the United States is first of all capitalist, but it also is a representative government. The Soviet Union, as it developed, looking toward communism, keep this in mind, the Soviet Union never claimed to have reached the stage of communism. They will claim later to have acquired socialism. All right? That's one of the reasons why I have a little confusion. But the Soviet Union, as it develops, becomes a dictatorship. All right, the United States, again, under capitalism, creates individual rights. Under the dictatorship of Joseph Stalin, the Soviet Union looks at society as a collective society. The individual exists for the state. Whereas under capitalism in the United States, the state existed for the individual. That is the conflict. You can still continue on and show time and time again the different conflicts, but these are the main ones. These are the ones that are going to perform that tension that's going to be created in the world. I could spend a lot more time on showing you conflict, but I'll go with that. All right, now, you would think that these two countries representing two different economic ideologies could never cooperate. But they did. They did from 1942 until about 1945. Because they had a common enemy. Adolf Hitler. Literally, with the conflict underneath. They had that common enemy, Hitler. Now, President Roosevelt, Franklin Delano, Rachel, I want you to notice I mentioned him. Franklin Delano Roosevelt literally saw the underlying conflict. And he thought, when Hitler is defeated, are we going back to the same old conflict? Isn't there some way we can avoid the conflict? To try to reconcile that, President Roosevelt drew up some ideas that he thought should guide the world after Hitler is defeated. He says, first of all, he said, I want the world to have free trade. What better way to ensure peace than the fact that you begin to trade with everyone in this world on an equal basis? And you need each other for the different products. You're certainly not going to fight someone that provides you with a food supply. I would think that would be rather foolish. Well, that's what Roosevelt felt like. If we can get this free trade to go, then the possibility of war would be lessened. All right, so that's a good idea. Then he says, all right, for all of us to be a part of this thing, we need also to have self-determination. He says every group in the world, every ethnic group in his mind, should have the right to determine for itself type of government it will create. That means the Slavic people in Eastern Europe will vote. And added to that, of course, self-determination would be free elections. He said those people will be allowed to vote to create their own government, their own state. Once again, that's an extremely idealistic viewpoint. But anything would be possible if you defeat them. That was the condition. All right, in addition to that, he says that there should be a disarmament. The countries should disarm. In fact, he would like to see where every country reduced the size of their army almost to a national police force. He says if you disarm that, then there'll be, again, little or no danger of war. So he's trying to ensure peace with these ideas. Then he came up, which I think is borrowing a little bit from history, he promoted the idea of a United Nations. A United Nations would be an international organization whereby if two countries have a disagreement, they can bring it to the United Nations. There they can negotiate. There they can develop a peaceful solution. Again, a way to ensure peace. That's the key to what Roosevelt is thinking. All right, now, the problem is none of this would be acceptable to Stalin. Because Stalin is not going to go along with any of this. So Stalin read, by the way, this is not Roosevelt's terminology, the journalists of the day began to label this as a one world vision. That is not Franklin Roosevelt's terminology. A lot of people take that terminology and try to distort it. Roosevelt's not looking for some supra government to govern the world. That the title the press gave it is misleading. But the press gave it the title One World Vision. Well, Stalin looked at that and said, okay, that's not going to go around. So he said, I would prefer that when Hitler is defeated, there will be created spheres of influence. He says the three major powers of the world, Soviet Union, the United States, and Great Britain, will rule the world. There'll be five that day together. And he even went so far as to garner his sphere. He said, I think I need Eastern Europe. I think I need a special voice in the Far East. And certainly I should have the cruel islands. And I would think the Sakhalin Island ought to be belonging to the Soviet Union. He said, and then of course, the Soviet Union should control the straits in the Dardanelles and the Bosphorus. That reminds me of the joke in World War II, where they said that Hitler always said, I want peace. He's wanting peace, but he's wanting a peace of the whole world. That is his sphere. That is where he will exercise control and domination. He will then also indicate the United States is free to take its share. Great Britain can take its share. In fact, he told Churchill, he said, Great Britain can take Africa. Wouldn't make him any difference. He has no interest in Africa. So he is dividing the world among the three major powers. Now obviously, if you start that spheres of influence with the three powers, how does that fit into one world vision? It doesn't. But let me point out, the spheres of influence is one way to maintain peace. It's not that far-fetched. If you've got three major powers, their territory is delineated, they are literally well-defined boundaries, you've got peace. Stalin even pointed out that among these three spheres of influence, you can have free trade. Involve human beliefs. Except for one thing. Stalin believes that ultimately, just as Karl Marx did, communism is inevitable. Communism, when placed in competition with capitalism, will win. So, the two concepts, starting out with your economic systems, have now developed into a personification of the United States and the Soviet Union. Okay, now,
they do come up with some formulations of
how they're going to conduct the war. But nevertheless, without Stalin, there's no reconciliation. All right, as the war progressed, again, there comes a call for a second conference, the Tehran Conference. Now, this time, Roosevelt and Churchill put it close enough to the Soviet Union that Stalin really couldn't come up with a good excuse not to attend. Tehran, of course, is right south of the Soviet Union in Iran. So, Stalin isn't at Iran. And again, they began to negotiate, trying to reconcile the two different points of view. That made a little progress, to say a little. For instance, Stalin agreed to the creation of a United Nations in principle. He didn't say he would agree to it totally. He said, in principle, I'll agree to it. Now, Roosevelt wanted Stalin to help him defeat Japan once Hitler is defeated. Stalin agreed, he said, soon after the defeat of Hitler, the Soviet Union would declare war on Japan. Well, then soon after, that could mean a day, or it could mean an eternity. You're just not quite sure what Stalin means at that point. Then they made some other arrangements, but it became obvious that there were major points of disagreement. So, as the leaders returned, war continued. Finally, another call for a conference, the Yalta Conference. That's the one that Roosevelt really is hoping that there'll be a major change. The Yalta Conference took place in February of 1945. Okay, as you can gather there, the war is coming to an end. The German armies are in retreat. They are moving both from the east and the west. It's not a question of if Hitler will be defeated, it's a question of when. So, the three leaders at that point have got to come to some reconciliation. If they don't, then it's all going to degenerate again into that conflict between communism, capitalism, Soviet Union, the United States. So, what they've got to try to do is reconcile now. It's going to happen, or so they hope. All right, they do come to some concrete conclusions. For instance, Stalin, in his generous way, said that when Hitler is defeated, the Soviet Union would declare war on Japan 2 or 3 months after the defeat of Hitler. He's being generous, isn't he? He said he would agree to the United Nations. But he also said, I want my sphere of influence. He said, I want the Kuril Islands. I want the Sakhalin Islands. I want Port Arthur, which is located in Manchuria in China. And I want special privileges in Manchuria. Stalin is carving out his sphere of influence. President Roosevelt felt that he had no choice but to accept that, because he thought he needed the Soviet Union's help in the defeating of Japan. American military advisors were telling Roosevelt that if the United States had to invade Japan, it would cost the United States 500,000 to 1,000,000 lives. Roosevelt's not willing to accept that cost. If the Soviet Union comes to and pins down the Japanese army in Manchuria and China, that invasion would be much easier. We'd still lose many, but the invasion would not lose that many. So Roosevelt felt I have no choice. So therefore he agreed to allow Stalin that sphere of influence He insisted that in Eastern Europe, that all the countries would have free elections. That was an agreement. What in Stalin's mind is a free election? It's where you have all your candidates as communists. So therefore, no matter what happens, you elect the communists. Now to Stalin, that's a free election. And so therefore, he felt perfectly okay in signing this agreement. He's not helping, he's not hurting anything or anybody. He's going to have three elections. Obviously, that's not what Roosevelt had in mind. And that's going to be a point of contention. Okay? Now, so Yalta is beneficial in some ways. Even Roosevelt admitted after Yalta that the agreement was highly beneficial to Stalin. He was willing to accept that for several reasons. All right, now, are you still with me? You see where Roosevelt's having to come from. All right, the Second World War then continues after Yalta. But then, in May 1945, Germany surrendered. VE Day, victory in Europe, took place. There's one problem. Roosevelt died April 12, 1945. He did not see the end of it. Taking his place is the Vice President, Harry S. Truman. Truman does not have the sophistication to understand international politics. Truman is a Missourian, and need I say more? Okay, you got the point. Truman took over not totally informed as to all of these agreements and all of the nuances to them. So, when Truman takes over, he asked for another conference to try to clarify some of this stuff. It's the conference at Potsdam. Truman and Stalin joined together at Potsdam. No major understanding took place at Potsdam. When Truman left, while he's at Potsdam, he was informed that the American scientist at White Sands, New Mexico had exploded the first atomic bomb, July 16, 1945. That changes the world. The genie is out of the bottle, and we can't put that genie back. All right, Truman then comes home, has to make the decision to end this war. Germany has surrendered. In the war against Japan, do I use the bomb? Well, there are arguments within Truman's administration and within the American scientists themselves as to whether or not we should use it. Truman made the decision to use it, to end the war once and for all. On August 6th, 1945, B-29 bomber dropped the first atomic bomb on the Japanese city of Hiroshima. They fully expected Japan to surrender. They gave Japan what they considered a decent time frame. Some people argue about that. August 9th, a second bomb was dropped on the Japanese city of Nagasaki. The Emperor of Japan made the decision, as he told his generals, I will ask my people to suffer for surrender. August 14th is the official surrender date. Now, the war is over. Hitler has been defeated. Japan is no longer a threat. You can guess what begins to surface. The old concepts of how we look at the world and look at our our societies. The Soviet Union, under the dictatorship, is a collective society still. The United States, under capitalism, is an individualistic society still. You can imagine the way in which these two economic systems viewed the world. And the conflict began. This time, it began when Truman took a stand. Truman saw the Soviet Union's free elections in Eastern Europe. And he said, that's not a free election. Period. So he began to push Stalin to have free elections. It's not going to work because Stalin is not going to give up Eastern Europe. He will retain control of it from heck or high water. So keep that in mind, and he's not going to give in. In fact, the real conflict came when Stalin told Truman, well, you need to dismantle the factories in Western Germany and send them to us. It's called reparations. We're going to make Germany pay for the war. Truman said no. He recognized that if they did that, Great Britain and the United States would literally have to feed the German nation for years to come. There could be no rebuilding of Germany. So Truman said no. So now you have two conflicts. One is the way in which you view the world, free elections. The other one is reparations. Truman is not going to allow that to happen. Then Stalin became real ambitious. Stalin had a Soviet army in the northern part of Iraq. And so he just made it plain that he intended to take Iran. So many people say, well, he wanted the oil. Might be. But I think more than anything else, Stalin wanted an outlet to the Indian Ocean. That would have been a whole lot more important to him in this worldwide conflict of communism. So I think at the heart of Stalin was the idea of going down to the Indian Ocean. The oil may have been beneficial, but you've got to remember the Soviet Union had its own oil. And plenty of it at that time. So I think it's the Indian Ocean that he was wanting to go for, to spread communism. So you've got now three conflicts. You've got the conflict of the free elections, you've got the conflict of reparations, and now Iran. And then, lo and behold, a fourth conflict occurred. Stalin is financing secretly. But everyone knew it. He is supporting communist insurrections in Turkey and in Greece. Now again, that's a logical thing for Stalin to do. Well, greed even never less logical. Because if he can take Turkey and Greece, he'll control the Straits. He'll have the Dardanelles and the Bosphorus. Tremendous choke points for American commerce. It would be an invaluable asset. So if he can have Turkey succeed to control the Straits, take a communist government in Greece, he's got it. If he can take all of Iran and get into the Indian Ocean, he's got it. Worldwide communist conflict. So therefore, Truman has got to find a way to counter Stalin and the Soviet Union. May surprise you, but then Truman read an article published in the Journal of Foreign Affairs. It was written by George Killen. Killen had been an ambassador, a United States ambassador to the Soviet Union. And Killen summed up his concept. He said, you cannot take Eastern Europe away from the Soviet Union. It cannot be done. They will not give it up. He said, America should adopt the concept of containment. In other words, stop them where they are now. Do not allow them to continue to expand. Contain the Soviet Union within the borders that it now has. Truman adopted that. So many times, historians will say it's amazing Truman read. Truman doesn't get as much credit sometimes as he deserves, but he adopted containment as the American policy. Therefore, he's got to deal with Iran, Turkey, and Greece. That's the immediate. Those are the acute crises. First of all, he told Stalin, take your army out of Iran. Why would Stalin pay any attention to that? Remember, the United States has a monopoly on the atomic law. And Stalin was not willing to test it. Remember, and always keep this in mind even today, the United States is the only country who has ever used the atomic law in a matter of war. And please remind all of our enemies of that. Stalin is not willing to push that. So he withdrew his army from Iran. One problem solved. Then Truman, looking at Turkey and Greece, decided on what we call the Truman Doctrine.
Controlled by the United States.
he offered the money to the Eastern European countries. Those countries dominated by Stalin, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Bulgaria, Romania. He offered American aid, American money to those countries. Well, Stalin obviously forced those countries to say no. He did not want capitalism to put a foot in those countries. I'm saying it's a little worried. I'm not sure he really believed communism would win or not. He's not willing to put the competition there. So he stopped. And when he did, only one Eastern European country accepted American aid under the Marshall Plan. And that country was controlled by a communist, a man by the name of Tito, in the country of Yugoslavia. Tito accepted the Marshall money. And when he did, Stalin was furious. Because that could be the footprint of the United States, the footprint of capitalism in Eastern Europe. Stalin attempted to have Tito assassinated on three separate occasions. He wanted his Eastern European countries to be solidified in the whole concept of communism. He's going to call the puppet governments. So in Eastern Europe, only Yugoslavia accepted the Marshall money. The United States at that point began to rebuild Europe. Truman announced that Germany would be rebuilt. He indicated he would start a new German currency. That German currency would indicate a totally new nation, a recreation of Germany. Stalin was furious because he, if anything, he feared Germany. He feared the rebuilding of Europe. So he's disappointed in Yugoslavia. Now he has a challenge with the new German currency. In response to that, Stalin took a major action. May I stop the narrative here for just a minute? Just a minute. I'm quick, I promise. You get wound up, this is good stuff. At the end of the war at Yalta, they decided that Germany would be divided into occupation zones. Berlin would also be divided, since it's the capital. Berlin is within the Soviet zone of occupation. So therefore, Stalin said, okay, I'll teach them a lesson. He got all the land transportation in Berlin. Every bit of it. It's called the Berlin blockade. He thought that the Western powers would then back away, they would surrender Berlin, Soviet Union could occupy it, they would give up the idea of rebuilding Germany. Stalin doesn't understand Missouri. Truman and the American military, along with the British military, drew up plans for what they called the Berlin Airlift. They intended to supply a city of 2.5 million people with the necessities of life by air. And Truman let it be known, if there was any of those flights fired upon, it would be World War III. It's probably one of the most courageous decisions of the 20th century. And yes, there were accidents. Men lost their lives flying supplies in the river. There were crashes, but the question was it Truman's mind, he saved 2.5 million people in communism. And that was the crux of Truman. The Berlin blockade lasted almost a full year. I have to tell you this, that at the Berlin airport, planes were landing and taking off in 2 minutes. And they did it. They broke the blockade. Okay, I'll have to quit at that point. Hate to leave you in such suspense. I think you can see how the Cold War began to cause the tensions. It will last until what I classify as the end of the Cold War as November 9th, 1989, when, after a long story, the Berlin Wall crumbled, ending the Cold War. I wish I had another 4 or 5 sessions we could really get into. I thank you for coming very much. I am truly humbled by your presence. Thank you.